Hey friends, Jacques here. Today we look at Chris Hein's latest release, Octa, from his newborn megastructure series. It's an exciting product from Chris, and I suggest you get your popcorn because this won't be a long video. If you have bought the Octa, you'll find some bonus gift at the end of the video. If you're a Cubase user like me, you'll probably like it. Remember, you'll find the chapters down here, so you can choose and watch the topics that interest you the most. And if you like the video, man, please leave me a like and consider subscribing. It's only a babe channel and it will help me continue creating music videos about the guitar world, music technology, the MIDI composer universe and whatnot. So hey, let's go! Before we dive into the details and sophistication of Octa, let's first understand it as if we were a 5-year child. Why Octa? Octa, from the megastructure series, refers to the 8-channel interface and engine you see right after loading it. The engine interface allows you to load up to 8 instruments and then play them individually or, if you prefer, as a multi-layer patch. Nice. Hey, voice over. I'm a 5-year-old child, remember?
Yes, you are.
So please, provide some practical examples here for us. You got it. After you've loaded the Octa, click on this area, which will show you several presets. Let's select the preset number 1, the clean start, and load it. Okay, little toddler, we've just loaded a vibraphone dynamic patch on channel 1 of the interface. That means you listen only to the vibraphone if you play your keyboard. Therefore, we're using the interface to play a solo instrument. Logic and reason will suggest that we'll be able to populate all the following channels with more instruments and then play them individually or as a multi-layer patch. Got it? Yeah, I think we got it. If all I need is to play a bunch of solo instruments, loading only one contact instance will get it done, right? Right. We'll investigate MIDI mode under the settings page later on. Here, you set up the interface as an instrument, having all the channels and instruments responding to the same incoming MIDI signal. Alternatively, to react to individual MIDI channels from 1 to 8, you set it up as a channel. Great, it's clear now, thank you. One more question before I move on to the interface details and pages. How many instruments and sounds do we have in Octa? According to the bestsurfs.com, it comes with 100 instruments, 64 acoustic instruments, 32 carefully selected synths, and 4 percussion sets with 1,500 samples. Excellent, thank you. I must say, enjoying playing the real instruments that Chris has sampled here, you know. There's some lovely jams, and don't worry, we'll listen to them in our audio demo section later. But for now, I'm out of coffee. But my voiceover will guide you through the interface pages and details, so I'll see you in a minute.
Hey guys, so now I'll guide you through all the pages and options you can find in Octa, okay? So now it's time to get a popcorn, because that's gonna be long. Let's go!
Okay guys, so as you can see, when you load the Octa, you have 6 pages. The mixer page, main, effects, presets, sequencer, and settings. This little green dot here will turn the sequencer page on or off. But for now, let's come back to the mixer page. Great, so in the mixer page, actually it's pretty simple. You have the channels from 1 to 8, and you have this little orange dot that will turn on and off each one of the different instruments. Okay, 2, 3, there you go. Then you have a solo button that will solo the instruments that want to be soloed, the name of the instrument, a pan slider, let's come back to 0, and a level slider. Before moving to the main page, let me give you a quick tip that may help you navigate through the Octa's interface. If you click here in the clean start, this little area here, that's gonna lead you to the instrument presets. So that means that all these presets are a combination of instruments, so multi-layered pads. Let me load something here, the 15. So it's loading. So now we get a combination of different instruments and synthesizers and real instruments creating a multi-patch instrument. So, okay, we don't want it right now. Let's select the clean start again
and load. Loading. Okay, so now if you select on this little area here, on this square, kind of square area, it's gonna take you to the channel presets as opposed to the instrument presets. So you can load only, like, say, real instruments, marimba hard. Can go to channel 2 and select some wood instruments like slit drum one, great one. So you can populate these instruments by selecting individual instruments if you want, you know, by going here. As opposed to click here in this little area, clean start, where you can load multi presets. Okay, that will help us continue to analyze and understand the interface. Let's go. Great, let's move to the main page. There's a lot to cover here, actually, but let's start by realizing that we still have the on and off button, you know, of each one of the channels. You can turn it on and off. You still have the solo, the pan, the volume slider, and the name that will, you know, lead you, take you to the channel presets. So let's click again. So we're back to the main page. From top to bottom, let's understand what these buttons do. The scale and the key, they will work together with this chord roll, you know, but let's first understand the scale. Let me play a keyboard. Hope you can see the notes down here. Okay, these two buttons are actually kind of a mid input transformer. I don't know how Chris calls them, but they're exactly what they're doing. Let me show you something. I will select a C minor scale. Now, regardless of the notes I've played on the keyboard, the input mid-transformer will actually move the note to the nearest note of the scale. Actually, transforms the notes I play on the keyboard conform to the C minor scale. So it doesn't matter what I play. It's actually magically transforming the notes I'm playing into notes that belong to the C minor scale. How can we use the buttons, scale, key, and this roll chord together? How can I do that? Okay, so let me see which options we have here. So I have octave, third, fifth, 1, 3, 5, and other numbers. Let us understand that. So first, if I select octave, so it's only adding a note, an octave above the note played. It's that simple, guys. So I can keep going and add a third, it's a major third, and a perfect fifth, and there you go. But now we have 1, 3, 5. These numbers refer to the triad, the basic triad. So if I play a C note on my keyboard, I will have a C major. C, E, G would be the notes forming this chord. Well, that's complex, but that's it. So what exactly can I do with this scale button right now? If I keep this 1, 3, 5 selected under this chord roll, if I move to scale, let's set up something like, you know, a major scale. Let's keep it simple. And E. So I have an E major scale now. So let's play the note E on my keyboard. Okay. So now I have informed the chord roll that I'm playing a E major scale. So if I play an E note on my keyboard, I'm going to have an E major chord, you know? So if I play a F sharp, which is actually the second degree of the E major, I will automatically have a F sharp minor. It's magic. So now the G sharp minor and so on. E major and B major. Let's move. Okay, transpose and tune. If I play a note and move the transpose, the slider is transposing my notes to the selected number, you know? So a semitone, and two semitones, and so on. The tune will tune your sound. Let me give you an example. Play a note and move the slider. Oh, it's going, you know, in semitones as well. What's cool about the tune is that if you hold down shift and move the mouse, it's going to be tuning your sound, your note, in cents, and not only in semitones. Let's move to type. Let's investigate it. We have layer, blend in, blend out, pad center, A to age and release. Whenever I have it set at layer, which is default position, I can just play my instrument and I can hear to that. The instruments will be layered upon each other and that's it. You know, there's nothing happening. However, when I select blend in, it means that this instrument, you know, the vibraphone dynamic in the control in the channel 1 depends upon my movement of the CC11. So let me play or can hear nothing. So let me move my expression here on my touch OSC. As I move it up, you can see there's these beautiful lines moving up. Okay, and now down and up. That means that in order to listen to this instrument, I need to move my CC expression up. So up and down. Blend out does the opposite, you know? If my control is up, as it's right now, I can't hear anything. So I move it down, I can hear the instrument. So it's cool, you can set some instruments to be blend in and another ones to be blend out. It's a cool option and feature. Moving to pad center and pad A to age. These options, pad center, for example, are related, connected to the XY pad. I have a touch OSC have set up to use with my XY pads here. So the X axis is actually CC3 and Y CC4. Let me move my here. Oh, it's working. That's great. So, if I have one of these instruments set to be in pad center, that means I will listen to an instrument whenever the pad is positioned at the center. As I move it to other positions, for example, direction, sorry, that's F or V and A, I can't hear my instrument anymore. In order to listen to that, I have to move the pad to the center. So it's simple, no? I think you got it. Let's go to the pad A. Well, I think got it right now, right? If it's positioned at A, you have the full level of your instrument. If you move it from A towards, I don't know, the H, now I can't hear it anymore. So as I get nearer to A, I can hear it again. So it's the same, you know, for all these pads. So it's a very cool way of morphing between different instruments. You know, you can have A different instruments and a move your XY pad to have some kind of beautiful blending between all of them. Okay, moving to release, which is the next option. Let me play a beautiful chord. Now release. That's it. You can hear this instrument whenever you release the notes. Again. Okay. So that's it for now. Let's move to the output. Okay, the output. Let's see what you have. We have default, which is a stereo. And you have stereo 1 to 8, actually. Well, that's it. You can send each one of these instruments to a different output, you know, and receive them in your DAW. That's it. But beware, when you do that, you actually bypass the insert FX that you find in the FX page. Next. Okay, Keyrange. What do we have here? Let's click on Keyrange. Oh, that's a nice interface. So what do we have here? We have Keyrange for each one of our instruments. You know, as I move this left handle, you can see that I'm actually changing the key range I can use for that particular instrument, the vibraphone dynamic. No? Can you see? You're moving the left handle and the right handle, and it's changing these blue keys. And these blue keys illustrate the particular range you're able to play in this instrument. Let me give an example, play some notes. Yeah, I can't play anymore. Out of range here. It's a great feature, actually. So if you keep going, you have 8 different instruments. You can select different key range for each one of them. Next. Now the envelope function. Let's click on it and see what you have. Okay, let me play a note. Here you can set the attack, hold, decay, sustain, release, and the curve for each one of the instruments. You know? So let's move the attack. And I have the hold, decay, and sustain, and release. So let me do something here. That's great. Can create interesting instruments with that. Doesn't sound like a vibraphone anymore. Not at all. Okay, as a nice tip, you can hold down Command and click on each one of these parameters, and they will be, hopefully, reset. Next. Okay, now velocity. If you click in velocity, you're going to see different options for velocity curves. You have linear, shelf, comp, expand, fix, and range. I must confess that I haven't gone through all of them because I tend to keep it linear. But you can have your instrument respond differently as you play by selecting different velocity curves. An interesting thing to do with that, with this random knob and slider, is as you move it up, you will randomly change your velocities. For example, not sure if you can see, but I will zoom in out for you, zooming in for you. If I play a note, you have the in velocity 64 and I have the out 93. It's randomly changing the input velocities to something else according to the amount I select here. So let's go crazy. Yeah, 102 goes to 71. But I must confess that for me, it's going to be linear and no randomization at all. Default settings. Let's go. Last option in the main page is the key switch. Let's click. Okay, it's currently off. So let's turn it on. Oh, now it's on. So key switches. What can we do with this key switch in Octa? Well, we have 8 different channels. So we can set up to 8 different key switches. Any of these key switches can be used to select one or more instruments at the same time. You know, up to 8 instruments. Let me show you. Let's turn on the channel 2. Let's turn on the channel 3 and the channel 4. I don't even think we need to load instruments to demonstrate that. Let me reset it to 4 key switches. So here we go. So in this column, in the channel 1, I have right now all the key switches selected, C0, C-sharp 0, D0, and D-sharp 0. What I mean is, all these orange squares are turned on. So let me turn off some of them. So now what you see is, the C0 is triggering the vibraphone dynamic, the channel 1. If I move to my next column, the channel 2, what I can do is I can turn off the C0, let the C-sharp 0 on, and turn off the D0 and D-sharp 0. Can do the same thing for the channel 3. Now again. That's great. Okay. So, pay attention to the fact that we have this orange dots here representing which one is selected, currently selected. So, if we go on the keyboard, I can click on the C0. Oh, now my key switch has moved to channel 1. If I click in the C-sharp 0, which has been selected to trigger the channel 2, let me do it. Boom. So, here you go. Channel 2. If I click on D0, okay, here we go. It has gone, has moved to channel 3. So, let's click on the D-sharp 0, which will move our key switch representation to our channel 4. Next. Great, let's move to the effects page and see what you have here. Effects page. Okay, so I have 3 views, A, B, and C. I prefer using the C view because it gives me access to all the effects, you know? We'll see that. But if you want to see your level, your pan, you can move to A, B, C, or go to mixer, amen, you know. But let's come back to effects and see what you have here. So, okay, from top to bottom, we have 6 channel effects, a filter per channel, 6 send effects, plus 8 insert effects. It's a lot. Okay, besides that, I have the vibrato options, you know, the bottom of the interface. So let's come back to effects 1. I'm going to show you what you have here. I have filter, EQ, dynamics, amp, stomps, delay. I think it's pretty much the native instruments reverbs that you have in contact. I may be wrong, but I think they are. Okay, moving to filter. You have 1 filter per instrument. That's great. You have different filters here. I have cutoff, resonance. Here you can send your cutoff to the envelope, you know, so you can control them. And interesting to notice that you have the control CC17 to control the cutoff and 18 to control the resonance. That's beautiful. So you can the envelope response. And there we go. Moving to the insert FX, we have all the same effects we have up here, you know, but now use the insert FX. Now it's time to remember you that when you use the output to stereo 1, 2, 3, or 4, you actually bypass the insert FX. Actually, it refers to these guys, you know. But hey, you have 6 channel effects plus the shared ones, you know, so you have a lot. Come on. Yeah. And the vibrato will give you an option to turn on and off the vibrato for each one of the instruments. And you have the intensity controlled by CC1. Let's move my modulation here. Yes. And the speed, which is CC6. Here we go. Mm-hmm. The modulation, the intensity, actually controls the volume, pitch, and the EQ. So when you increase the intensity, you know, you'll be able to use these parameters to change the way your vibrato sounds. Great. Moving to presets page. Some cough. Mm-hmm. Presets page. What do we have here? Okay. I believe we have already covered the presets page, because there's nothing here that's new, you know, that you should know. But always remember, when you're dealing with Octa's presets, there's a difference between the instrument presets, channel presets you can see here, and the instrument presets. Okay, channel presets are actually presets that you can load and save for a solo instrument, or in other words, for this slot here, the channel 1. When you move to presets page, you have the instruments presets, which are combinations of different slots and instruments. So again, let me load some. The 7, which is nice piano bells. Okay, here are all these slots populated with different instruments. So this one, the 7, has been saved as an instrument preset, which has the combination for all of them. Okay. So if I click in the vibraphone dynamic here, it leads me to the channel presets, as opposed to the instrument presets, which you can have access by clicking on this page here. That's it, man. Moving on. Okay, let's go, guys. Let's go to the sequencer page. We have this green dot here, which will turn on the sequencer page. So, okay, it's turning it on. First thing, let me load another instrument. Synth, breathing warm, and come back to the sequencer page. Okay, here you have a on and off button for each one of your instruments. So you can turn the sequencer on for your vibraphone dynamic while keeping off for your breathing warm. Okay, this is something that you can easily miss. You can turn on and off for each one of your instruments. So for now, I'm just clean start again. And I will not guide you through the every tiny detail of the sequencer page, because there's a lot here. So you should refer to the manual. I have mine here, you know? So instead, let's take a look at the bass things you can do with that. Okay, guys, so bass things you can do with that. Or not that basic. Let's see what I can have here. And play a note. Okay, so it's already using the sequencer. I will not guide you through the different note values, but you can change it here. And there's a lot of things you can do. You can speed it up and down, which is basically doubling the speed or playing half speed. Let's keep it one by one. Okay, so let's take a look at this parameters here. Velocity, volume, panorama, transpose, tuning, blah, blah, blah. Okay, velocity. Great. Let's go to volume. Let's change the volume of the first note. Okay, it's clear here. Okay, panorama, pan. Let's move the panorama here. Okay. Transpose. Here can transpose your notes. I like it. And tune. Okay. Why not? Sounds beautiful. Length of notes. Not much change in here. And the notes. Okay. Here, let me stop here. You should refer to the manual to understand all that these notes are doing, you know? But I'm gonna change it to chord only. Okay, play again. Now we can basically change what the sequencer is doing with your notes. You know, you have the up, down, that would change the way it adds the notes. Please, take a look at the manual. Moving on, you have the filter. Okay, here you can turn the filter on and off, as you can see. Let's turn it on. But again, when you turn the filter on here on the sequencer page, please come back to the effects page, go to the filter, and hit OK. That sequencer is controlling your filter. So let's come back to the sequencer page and draw some automation for your cutoff. Okay, so now let's come back to your effects page, go to the filter. So now we can see that the cutoff slider knob, I never know how to call that, is being moved by your sequencer page. You can do the same thing with the resonance, of course. So let's come back to effects page, filter, and now your resonance is being controlled, right? So really easy to do. Moving to pad. Okay, pad. As you can see, your pad is off. So how do we do here? We go to our main page, type, and select at least one of these pads. Sorry, not at least, one of them. let's use the pad center. Come back to the sequencer page. So now it's on, okay? Let's move here. Yeah, it's okay. Let's keep it center and play a note. Great. Okay, you can move your pad. I don't know if you're recording with Cubase or any other DAW, actually record what you're doing. Okay, let me keep it center. But you can also record the pad automation using this interface. Let me see if I can do that. You can turn the pad automation on. So now nothing happens yet. It should come here to record. Okay, let me click on record and play note. So now it's recording what you're doing. So let's do something here. Oh, no, sorry, I didn't hit record. Now it's waiting for me again. Okay, I did it. I got it. That's it. I've recorded it here. So let's go to the send effects. Okay, so the send effects. And play a note. I wasn't bad. Now it's send effects. Okay, here we have a sequencer for our shared effects, for our send effects that you have here, you know? All of this, convolution, reverb, delay, R, chorus, phaser, flanger. So let's come back. So let's go to convolution, turn it on. Okay, so first let me come back to effects, convolution, and select a huge one. I don't know, I think that 12.5 seconds, 11.5, I like 11. Okay, can hear anything. So it's convolution. Let me automate it now. It's turned on. So it's sending more effects, more signal to my convolution reverb. Just a tiny bit. Maybe one note to have a lot of reverb, like that one. Just that one. Or the first one. So, as you can see, it's an easy-to-use interface. It's a really easy-to-use sequencer. So if all we want to do is to add some movement by using velocity changes, volume, panoramas, or even automate your filter, your effects, well, it's a very convenient interface that allows you to do it quickly. You know, I really like it. And the fact that you can automate the pad within the interface without even going outside, you know, using Cubase or whatever, makes it very desirable software to create loops. You know, maybe all I want to do is to create a quick loop. I don't know about you, but I tend to have really busy sessions at the end of my pieces and compositions. So sometimes I want to add some loop or spice here and there, and I don't want to use a made loop, a pre-made loop. So I like to create something new and have an interface that I can just load some sounds, create some movement using the available effects and sequencer. Well, it's very interesting and desirable, at least for me, you know. I hope you have fun with this Octa product from Chris. I really love that. Great, settings page. So let's click here. Here's the interface of settings page. Okay, you can turn on and off the instruments you have loaded, have the name of the instruments, the solo instruments. And besides that, you can see the XY pad. You have the pad automation on and off. And you have the volume pan, where you can select different CCs, both for your volume and pan. Now I have the filter, which is currently set at default, which is 17 for cutoff and 18 for resonance. Okay, so here you have your pad automation. If I play a note, it's showing you what you have automated using your XY pad. Apart from that, I have the MIDI mode. I have already gone through that. You can set it as instrument, which you basically made all channels respond to the same MIDI instrument, and channels, which will respond from channels from 1 to 8. Then please refer to the manual, but here you have the round robin setting with a repeat key aiming E-1. The blend mode is set at 11, which is the default one which we have used. The vibrato to 1 and 6, you know, intensity modulation, and speed at 6. I have sequencer set X fade CC1, variation key C-1, and the pad set at 3 and 4. 3 for the pad X CC and 4 for the pad Y CC. Great, so let's move to the next stage of your video. And don't ever forget, I love the default settings. Hey, I'm back. It seems has taken more than 1 minute, right? Anyway, I hope you have enjoyed it and learned something. I'm still discovering Octa's capabilities and features, but it has one of the coolest interfaces I've ever used. It makes the process of layering sounds considerably straightforward. It's really uncomplicated to load some instruments in the slots, add some effects, and use the sequencer to create motion. So, let's move on. Let's listen to some of the inbuilt multi-layered pads. It's nearly impossible to go through them since they're numerous, you know, but however, I'm confident it will provide a glimpse of how they sound and the overall quality of the library. I'm calling you back, VoiceOver.
Oh, come on!
Okay, guys, so let me guide you through some of the lovely Octa's multi-layered pads. So let me click right here. So let's load some of them. Mallet's nice and simple. Let me see if there are some Octa pads. Yeah, I have some pad configuration here. Okay, let me load something else. It's using the key switch. Let me play C0. C#0. As you can see, you have a different configuration of instruments. Now I have the channel 2, 6, and 7. If I click on C0, it changes the number of instruments I'm using now. Channel 1, 5, and 8. So C#0. D0. Great, let's move on. mallets, hand pan keys. Great one. Okay, piano pad layer. Great piano, actually. A bambule. Yeah, guys, there's a lot of instruments here to check out. Let's see this 39, which is the pad strings, pad key switches. Okay, so all the suffix key, KS, refer to the pads that have key switches configured. So I can paste something here. I like that. Let's see the key switch. Currently using the C0, so now C#0. It will change the number of instruments. Okay, changed. So now D0. D#0. Beautiful instrument. Okay, fat pad 2. Great, really great. Let's see some of these XY pads. Open heaven, let's see this one. Just one note. Okay, we'll play just one note and then move the pad. It's great. Let's see this harp in monochord. Let's see some piano and keys. Piano and keys, let's see this sad piano. Okay, let's see something else here. Guitarette with a shadow. Let's move to something else. These ones have sequencer turned on. Mm-hmm. great. Let's see some expectation. Mm-hmm. So bass tube sequencer. Sequencer 122, it's interval bass. Key overdriven 126. Okay, something else. Guitar mutes. This one has the pads. Let's see the pads. Okay, guitar in space. Okay, so that's it. It was a quick rundown of some of the sounds. So, Talking Head, it's with you. Thank you, VoiceOver. Nice camera. Hopefully you have seen how lovely Chris Hein's work was. As I said, it's hard to go through all patches because that will bore you. Anyway, I hope it was enough to give you a glimpse of Octa's multi-layered patch. Patches. Now it's time to demonstrate some of the solo instruments of the Octa's library, which is one of its strengths. There are plans to expand Octa's sound library, which gives me the confidence, you know, to use it continually in my current and future projects. Yeah, because there's a learning curve for every software we decide to use, so knowing beforehand that the library got expanded makes me confident that I'll be investing my time in an ever-growing environment. Great, so regarding my audio demo, I loved Octa sounds and it would be great to experiment to compose a demo using only the solo instruments. Don't you think? Well, I do. That allowed me to test the recorded sounds and see if they would hold on to an actual battlefield or in a better choice of words in a music field. Because layering one sound on top of others tends to shadow its weaknesses. As a consequence, using them as the protagonists allows for better testing and evaluation of the library's qualities. I'll give you an example of how I have processed the sounds in Cubase. Mr. VoiceOver? Great. Let's look at one example before we listen to the audio demo. In the master section, there's only a frequency plugin, which is adding a gain. Have turned off all the other plugins, so there's no processing happening here at all. So, okay, let's move to our hand pan fingers and hand pan's thumbs. I'm sure you the contact instance. Okay, it's here. So there's no effects at all here. It's just the natural raw recording that Chris has done. So I'm using four hand pan fingers, first four channels, and four hand pan thumbs from channel 5 to 8. Okay, so let me play it for you. Okay, it's enough, just to give you an example. So what's going on here? So let me mute and pan thumbs, the reverb and the delay. I'll turn off deep group processing and all the plugins I am using for. Cool. Okay, so I had one hand pan finger at the center here and two hand pan thumbs, one to the left and the other one to the right, as you can see here. So first, let's listen to the first hand pan finger. No processing at all, no reverb, no delay, no anything, just a recording. Great, so what have I done here? I'm using this incredible PSP InfiniStrip plugin to process the hand pan finger. Okay, so let's center it. Okay, there's not much going on. It's the pre-70s, which is probably a 1073 preamp simulation, which sounds great. And some gain, some harmon distortion here, a basic EQ, 1 dB at 2K, 48, almost nothing, you know. Opto compressor and a master control, which is actually just balancing the input and output. So when I turn the plugin on, it doesn't have a lot of more levels, so it confuses me into thinking that it's better. So let me just play first with the plugin. No plugin. So as you can see, it's really subtle. Yeah, you could say there's nothing going on, but there is. It's actually up and a little bit, adding some thumb in the low mids, subtle harmon distortion, and a soft compression. Let's listen without the plugin and focus your attention into transients, you know, in the attack of the notes. Okay, so let's listen with the plugin on, and again, pay attention to the transients and see how the compressor is actually reducing the transients in a very smooth and natural way. You see? Yeah, great. After this plugging, I'm sending these hand pan fingers and the hand pan thumbs to this group, you know, which then have more processing. But first, let's listen to the hand pan fingers and thumb with their processing with no delay and no reverb. And by the way, the hand pan thumbs 1 and 2 have been processed in a very similar way with 1 PSP infinite strip and a frequency after that. Well, it's just cutting off some of the low mids here, around 186 hertz. So let's listen to the three instruments, you know, with no processing in the group channel yet. Sorry, again. Okay, if you want to listen to details, there is this hand pan thumb at the left. And this one is at the right. Okay, so now the three. Great. These three instruments were sent to this group, the hand pans. So what do we have here? First plugin is the UAD Studer A800. It's adding a beautiful, natural, soft, lovely tape compression. It's subtle, but it makes a huge difference, at least for me. Turn it off. On. You see? Yeah. After that one, we have an LH2A, this model. Moving on, we'll have the pull tag. The AKB1A, which is adding some thump and a high frequency. Moving to the next one, we have the mid-range Poltec, the MAK5, which is just gently cutting off 200 and add a little bit of the mid-frequency around 1.5. So let's listen to the hand pans without the reverb and delay for a while. That's great. So now the reverb. Okay, now the reverb. Let me show you. I'm using this PSP 2445, which I will usually use whenever my lexicon random howl doesn't work. I think that this PSP reverb is probably one of the greatest PSP plugins. I'm not sure if it's underrated or not, what people think about that, but I just love that one. It has a beautiful modulation, very lexicon-ish. Well, it's supposed to be. So let's listen to this reverb. Okay, I kind of overdid it, but that's the idea. Listen to the modulation. What happens is after I stop. Beautiful one. Let me exaggerate it even more. So moving on, we have delay, which then it's the waves edge delay. I don't know why I keep coming back to this delay. Like how it sounds, love the lo-fi mode, you know? So let's listen to the whole pack now. Great, hope you've enjoyed it. Let me show you the Cubase session. This is all the instruments that you have in our demo. From top to bottom. That's awesome. So now let's listen to the demo. Bye-bye. I guess this example has given you an idea of how I've processed Octa sounds and instruments, you know? So now let's listen to the demo and we'll catch up later. Okay guys, it's the end of our review of Chris Hein's Octa from his Megastructure series. I want to congratulate Mr. Chris Hein for producing Octa. I love the interface and I will use it whenever it fits my projects. I know how tiresome it is to create software, review it, debug it and whatnot. So Chris, Thank you for making this interface, man. Several people will thank you too. I desire to see Octa's future library getting bigger and bigger into more synths and real instruments. So, Mr. Chris, you'll have a lot of work in the following years. Please, keep the library growing. We like it. Now, my gift to you all. You can download the entire Cubase session of my Octa's audio demo, so you'll be able to reuse my plugin processing in your music, as long as you own Octa and all the plugins I have employed here. You are welcome. Please, like the video, subscribe to my channel, check out my website for my free Cubase presets. You'll thank me later, man. If you want to support this channel, there's a PayPal link in the description. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.